Thank you very much, Riccardo.
Thank you very much, Marcello, and also Chiara for the invitation. I'm really sorry not to be here, actually, but the exams are a big duty for us. And so I will talk about a joint work, actually, with Dario Bambusi and Beatrice Langella. So it is about a result on the growth in time of the Sobolev norms for Schrödinger equations on any torus with unbounded perturbation. So let me just describe a little bit the plan of the talk. So I will give an introduction to the problem, and I will comment about the known results and our result. I will give a precise statement. Then I will go to the method. The method is actually a normal form procedure. And so I will actually emphasize the strong connection that there is in normal form theory between classical and quantum mechanics. Actually, it turns out that our procedure is actually the quantization of the classical normal form procedure and actually of the Nekrashov theorem. So the Nekrashov theorem is actually based on a normal form lemma, which is the analytical part of the Nekrashov theorem. And then an analysis of the normal form equation, which is actually called the geometric part. So in the geometric part, it is actually essential to analyze the resonances. And then this is actually the content of the last part of the talk, in which also I will emphasize the relation between classical and quantum mechanics. So let me go to the problem. The problem is actually the linear Schrödinger equation with a time-dependent potential. I will consider the equation on any torus. So how do you define a generic torus, even irrational? So you have U1, UD, the independent vectors in RD. And then you consider the linear combinations of these D vectors by means of integer numbers. Okay, so this is what is called the maximal lattice in RD. And then the torus related to this lattice is simply defined by the quotient between RD and gamma. Then V of T is actually a family of self-adjoint and also unbounded operators of order 2, of order strictly smaller than 2. You can think the main physical example, I would say that it is the time-dependent magnetic potential, which is this one. And my aim is to provide, as I said, a growth in time of the Sobolev norms for the solution of the equation 1. And actually what I will prove is that the Sobolev norms grows polynomial in time with the power which can be chosen arbitrarily small independent of the Sobolev index. Let me go a little bit to the setting in order to state precisely my theorem. So actually you can define on a generic torus the Fourier series. So you have Fourier analysis. Simply by expanding on the dual lattice, actually, which is this gamma star, which is defined like this. Well, you can think also to the standard torus, okay? So in the case of standard torus, you have the standard torus TD, gamma is 2 pi z to the power d, and the dual lattice is simply zd. Then the H sigma norm is defined in Fourier by the Japanese bracket to the power 2 sigma times the modulus of the Fourier transform to the square, and you sum up on the dual lattice. Then what happens is that since the perturbation is self-adjoint, then of course the L2 norm is a prime integral for the for the equation. But then what you are interested in is to essentially to estimate the energy transfer to the high modes. So essentially this is measured by providing some upper bounds for the Sobolev norms of the solution. Actually, what happens also in the free case, so if you remove the perturbation V, then of course the Sobolev norms are essentially, also all the Sobolev norms are conserved quantities. And so if you add the perturbation, you want to study essentially the dynamics of the perturbed equation. An essential tool actually in my for our strategy is actually the pseudo differential calculus. So in the next two slides, I will recall a little bit at least the definition of symbols and pseudo differential operators. So what is a symbol? A symbol is a symfinity function of let's say position and momenta. So the positions are on the torus and the momenta are on RD. I say that F is a symbol of order M if essentially it has a growth like Xi to the power M, and Xi is the Japanese bracket defined as usual. And then there is also this additional property which says the following. So when I make a derivative in X, then nothing happens to the growth. And when I make a derivative in Xi, I gain some decay. So every derivative that I make in Xi, I gain some decay with respect to Xi. So here actually there is a misprint. It should be M here because I say SM. So two easy examples are, of course, the symbol of the Laplacian, which is modulus of Xi square, which is a symbol of order two. And then if you take a symbol which is independent of the frequency of the momenta, then it is clearly a symbol of order zero. Then these are classical Hamiltonians, and I need to quantize them. And then in order to have a class of operators. So how do I quantize these classical Hamiltonians with, well, I use the Weyl quantization. Of course, there are other quantization, for instance, the classical quantization, but I use the Weyl quantization because it is a little bit more convenient and you have some symmetry. It is defined in this way. So take a symbol over the M, then you can associate to a symbol over the N an operator A, so then I can define the class OPSM in the following way. So take the action is of the operator A is given by the following formula. So take a smooth function, then A applied to U is given by this formula. You have to sum up in two Fourier indices, K and Xi in gamma star. Then you take the Fourier transform of A with respect to the variable X, and you evaluate it at K and Xi plus K over two. Then you multiply it by the Fourier transform of U computed at Xi, and then you multiply by the exponential e to the I K plus Xi dot X. So an advantage of the Weyl quantization is that if A is a real symbol, then automatically the operator is self-adjoint, okay? And actually a crucial property is that if A is an operator of order M, then A is an unbounded operator of order M, in the sense that it is continuous from the Sobolev space H sigma into the Sobolev space H sigma minus M for any sigma. Two examples actually are, of course, the Ormander derivatives, so which are actually the Weyl quantization of the momenta, psi J. And then if you take a symbol which is independent of the frequency, then actually the Weyl quantization of it is exactly the multiplication operator by the symbol, okay? So let me state now precisely our theorem. So our theorem says that if you take a smooth family of self-adjoint operators, pseudo-differential operators of order strictly smaller than two, then you have the bound that I mentioned before on the Sobolev norms. And then this means that for any epsilon, for any sigma, there exists a constant C epsilon sigma such that the solution satisfies this bound. So the bound is norm of psi of T in H sigma is bounded by T to the power epsilon times the H sigma norm of the initial data. Okay. So let me actually mention some known results on the same kind of problems. So actually there is a clear picture of this problem when actually H0, I would say, has a trivial geometry of the resonances. So essentially this means that either M is one dimensional. So for instance, the one dimensional torus, or it is the quantization of an Hamiltonian, which is isochronous. So what does it mean isochronous? It means that the frequency does not depend on the action. So, I mean, anybody knows that when you do perturbation theory, you have to impose some non-resonance conditions. But then if the Hamiltonian is isochronous, you have non-resonance conditions which are independent of the point of the phase space. Whereas if the Hamiltonian is non-isochronous, you have the frequency which depends on the action, and then you have to impose some non-resonance conditions which depends on the point of the phase space. And this is exactly what happens in the case of higher dimensional tori. Okay? So the known results in this framework are only confined to unbounded potentials, to bounded potentials, so to multiplicative potentials. The first one is due to Bourguin. Then there is a nice proof of this result, which has been made by Jean-Marc Delors. And then there is a beautiful generalization of these results to irrational tori, which is actually a bit more complicated because on irrational tori, actually the separation properties of the eigenvalues of the Laplacian is violated. And this is due to Alberto and Massimiliano Berti. Just actually related techniques are actually come also from KM and reducibility. So actually let me focus more on the reducibility, which is actually also the key step to prove existence of periodic and quasi-periodic solutions for PDE. Because I mean, you construct them by an iterative method, and at any step of this iterative method, you have to solve a linear equation with the quasi-periodic in time potential. So the typical reducibility theorem says that actually if epsilon is small enough, and if omega is a suitable non-resonant vector, which has to satisfy some conditions which are called second Melnikov conditions, then actually there is no transfer of energy to high modes. So the Sobolev norms stays bounded for all time. So essentially if you move the frequency and if you have that the perturbation is small enough, then you don't have growth of Sobolev norms. And actually also here, there is a quite clear picture in dimension one. Let me mention the first breakthrough result by Sergei Kuksin in 87. Then also the generalization to unbounded perturbations was later. And actually the first result was to Dario Bambusi and Graffi. And it was still by, let's say, perturbative techniques, because actually in this case, the order of the perturbation is much smaller than the spectral gaps of H0. Then one can show that in this case, you can do a quadratic scheme and which is convergent. Well, in the case, for instance, of quasi-linear PDEs, the situation is much more complicated. And actually the key step was to introduce a normal form based on pseudo-differential calculus. So this was done in the case of periodic solutions for the water waves by Jos Plotnikov et al. And then by our group starting from 2014. Essentially, in which we generalize to the quasi-periodic case this procedure. Also, there are few results in higher dimension, and the problems that you have in higher dimension actually are the same that I described before. So the geometry of the resonances, which is more complicated, and so you have only few cases in which you can prove reducibility theorem. Let me just explain the general approach that you have on this kind of problem. So essentially you want to study the dynamics of this time dependent Schrödinger equation. So, and usually you have to do essentially two things. So one is a normal form lemma, which essentially simplifies somehow the perturbation V of T. And the outcome of this normal form lemma is actually another equation actually that is of the following form. So it is actually a normal form equation plus a remainder which is sufficiently regularizing. Okay. But then the key point is to study the dynamics of the normal form equation. So the normal form equation is the one in which you neglect the remainder. Okay. So, and what is actually what one tries to do usually is to prove that there is no transfer of energy to high modes for the normal form equation. Okay. And this is actually the delicate point, the more delicate point, because it really depends on the geometry of the manifold and also so on the resonances. So this is actually the most delicate point. I will describe actually a little bit in detail in some examples, the typical forms of this Z of T, which is the normal form that you get after a normal form procedure. But actually once you have done this, then you can prove easily the theorem. Why? Because essentially you write the Duhamel formula for the original equation, for this equation. Okay. For me, phi z is the flow associated to the normal form equation. And then you estimate the HN norm of the solution by means of the Duhamel formula. And then what you get is the following. You get, since because of the properties of the flow of the normal form equation, you get that this is bounded by the HN norm of the initial datum times the integral of actually R is n smoothing. Then you can do this estimate, R as an operator from L2 to HN times the norm of the initial datum in L2. And here I skip actually a passage. I used also that the L2 norm is conserved for all time. But then once you have this, you simply integrate in time and you get essentially a linear growth in time. So what does it mean? It means that of course you can come back to the original equation because you have conjugated the system by means of a bounded linear operator un of t, which is the normal form transformation. And then what you have on the flow of the original equation is that the flow of the original equation as a bounded linear operator in HN has a linear growth in time. And since n is arbitrary, this holds for any n, essentially. Then if you want to prove a bound t to the power epsilon, you simply use interpolation theory for linear operator. So you interpolate between L2 and HN with n, which is large enough, essentially. So the more epsilon is small, the more n has to be large. And then this implies that you get a growth which is polynomial in time as t to the power epsilon. But then, okay, let me focus on some particular case on the normal form equation. Actually, let's say the fortunate case for the normal form equation is when actually Z commutes with the Laplacian. Okay, if Z commutes with the Laplacian, then it's very easy essentially to prove that the HS norms are the prime integrals. Essentially, why? Because actually the Sobolev spaces are defined as a power of H0. Okay, so if you do an energy estimate for this equation and Z commute with H0, then actually you immediately prove that the Sobolev norms are constant. So easy cases are the following one. So the first one, of course, is a one-dimensional case in which one can show that the normal form operator is essentially a Fourier multiplier. So essentially in one dimension, you are able to remove the dependence of X from the symbols. And then, of course, a Fourier multiplier commutes with the Laplacian, and then you have this property here. In higher dimension, let me actually discuss the case of the quantum harmonic oscillator, which has been a nice result from Alberto Maspero, Dario Bambusi, Benoit Grébert, and Didier Robert. And it is the following. So you have the quantum harmonic oscillator. So it is the quantization of the classical harmonic oscillator with non-resonant frequencies. I mean, actually, if you write the Hamiltonian in action angle coordinates, you immediately see that it is isochronous. It is omega dot I, where I are the action variables. And then you can implement a normal form in order to remove from the remainders the dependence on the angles. So the outcome of the normal form is an Hamiltonian, which depends only on the action. And this actually implies that the normal form commutes with the Laplacian, H0, which is the quantization of the harmonic oscillator. And then you have also this normal form lemma on the normal form equation. So here, the key point is that, as I mentioned also before, that is that actually this Hamiltonian is the quantization of an isochronous Hamiltonian. So the frequency is independent of the action. And also then you impose non-resonance conditions which are independent of the points of the phase space. So this is really actually the quantization of the classical Birkhoff-Raphe algorithm. Then let me discuss maybe the more complicated case, which is the case of TD. And actually in the case of bounded perturbation, there is really this remarkable theorem from Burgen, which is actually the key point to prove the growth for this equation, to estimate the growth of the norms for this equation. And so the Burgen, it is called actually Burgen lemma. It should be known to most of you actually. So it says the following. It says that there exists a partition of the lattice, which is essentially a good clustering of the eigenvalues for the Laplacian. So the two key properties are actually the following one. The first one is a separation property, which says that if you take two indices in two different clusters, then the differences of the eigenvalues is large, okay? And as anybody knows, this is a good thing to do perturbation theory, okay? But then there is the second property, which is a little bit less obvious, which is which says that the blocks are dyadic in the sense that you can control the maximum of the modulus of J on any block by the minimum. And the constant here is independent of the block. Okay. Let me discuss how to use actually the second property. So of course the first property is actually used in the normal form lemma. And actually the outcome is still a normal form equation, which is in which the normal form is block diagonal in this sense. So it is block diagonal in the sense that if you compute the matrix elements with respect to the exponential basis, then they are not zero only if the indices are in the same cluster. Okay, but actually what is false is that Z of t commutes with the Laplacian. This is not true, absolutely. And then how do you do the energy estimate on the normal form equation? Well, you define actually a modified energy in a suitable way, which is the following one. So you take the minimum of the indices N of alpha is the minimum over J in the cluster of omega alpha of the Japanese bracket of J. Then you consider actually a function psi, the spectral projector of the function psi on any block generated by omega alpha. You do the L2 norm here and you sum up over all the N of alpha to the power 2s times the L2 norm of the spectral projection of psi in L2 to the square. So the dyadic property says that this norm is equivalent to the Sobolev norm. What is the advantage? The advantage is when you estimate the dynamics of the normal form restricted to any block, you can use the L2 norm. But then the L2 norm is always bounded because actually this operator is self-adjoint. And then if you sum up, you have actually an estimate of this form on the growth of Sobolev norms. So the Sobolev norms, there is no exchange of energy between, let's say, the different resonant zones. Okay. So let me come now to the case of unbounded perturbation, which is our case. So actually, essentially, in the proof of Delors in the case of bounded potential, so actually, this result was actually generalized also to irrational tori by Berti and Maspero, as I said before. And here, essentially, the key ingredient is to prove a Burgen lemma in the case of the irrational torus, which is actually highly non-trivial because, as I said before, the differences of the eigenvalues of the Laplacian can accumulate to zero. So you don't have separation property. It is more difficult, actually. And whereas in the case of, essentially, in this proof was missing a little bit the ingredient of pseudo-differential calculus, which is essential to deal with unbounded potentials. And actually our proof is based on pseudo-differential calculus, which allows essentially to run between to move from classical to quantum mechanics, essentially. So the difficulty in our procedure is actually that the corresponding classical system is actually the quantization of it is actually a perturbation of the Laplacian, and the Laplacian is the quantization of the Hamiltonian modulus of psi square. The frequencies for this Hamiltonian are exactly the actions. And then actually you will see that we have we will have non-resonance conditions which will be dependent on the point of the phase space. Okay, so maybe let me discuss a little bit the what happens in classical mechanics. So let me take actually an Hamiltonian of this form. So it is an epsilon perturbation of an integrable Hamiltonian, which I take simply modulus of psi square because it is what we have in our case. But actually the Nekonosher theorem also holds in a more general framework, but I don't want to discuss it now. The Nekonosher theorem actually says the following. So if the perturbation is sufficiently smooth, with also bounded derivatives and bounded with all its derivatives and with all nice properties on whatever you want. Then what happens is that is the following. So for any n, and if epsilon is small enough, the solutions of the Hamiltonian system corresponding to H satisfy the following estimate, which tells you that essentially the action does not move too much for long time. So for a time which is of order epsilon to the minus capital N, and capital N is arbitrary. The analytical part of this theorem is actually a normal form lemma, which actually says the following. For any capital N, you can find the change of coordinates, which is symplectic, which brings your Hamiltonian in the following form. So you have the unperturbed part integrable, which is H0 of psi, then you have a normal form Z, and then you have a remainder, which is small of order epsilon to the power N. And which are the properties of the resonant normal form is exactly what you are not able to remove, essentially. So it is well known that in perturbation theory, the small divisors are the frequency times integers. So these scalar products, and they go to the denominators, okay? So essentially you have to impose a lower bound on these numbers, but then what you are not able to remove are exactly these resonant strips, which is actually when the small denominators is actually very small. So it is of order epsilon to the power delta for some delta smaller than one. Then also I introduced, but this is a bit technical, an ultraviolet cutoff, which tells you that essentially you need to impose only a finitely many resonant condition for any point of the phase space. Maybe let me go to describe the first step of this normal form procedure. So essentially the first step is essentially I want to cancel as much as possible the order epsilon. So I want to move the perturbation up to order, let's say epsilon square. And then I consider actually a generating function G and the flow associated to a generating function. And I transform my Hamiltonian by using the Lie series. So the leading order in this expansion is given by the Poisson brackets between H0 and G plus epsilon B. And then this is exactly what I find in my homological equation. So I want to find G in such a way that V is simpler than the origin, in such a way to simplify as much as possible the perturbation. So if you compute this Poisson bracket, you get that, and you write G in Fourier series, you have that, indeed you have psi dot k applied to the Fourier transform of G if you write this in Fourier series. And then, I mean, in order to kill everything of V, you would like to divide by these numbers, which are psi dot k. But actually you cannot, because you have small divisors and you have resonances. So the problem is that actually you have exact resonances in the sense that psi dot k can vanish, really can be zero on hyperplanes which are orthogonal to k. And then actually a good definition of the non-resonant set you cut away actually your phase space in the following way. So you impose that Xi.k is bounded from below by epsilon to the power delta for some power which is of order, which is smaller than one. And then what happens in this non-resonant region is that the divisor can be estimated, okay? Because it is not zero in this region, and then one over Xi.k can be estimated by one over epsilon to the power delta. Then essentially what happens is that in this region, I can solve the homological equation. Okay, so what I do is essentially a splitting of my Hamiltonian. So the splitting is the following. So of course there is the average with respect to the angle. Then there is a part which is supported on the high modes in Fourier. And you can show that since the A is infinity and it is supported on high modes, then you have these can be actually as small as you want. So this notation means that it is of order epsilon to the power n for any n. Then there is the non-resonant part of the Hamiltonian, which is the one that you want to kill, which is essentially you write in Fourier the Hamiltonian, and then you restrict to the region of the phase space where the denominators of the homological equation are large. And then there is the non-resonant part, which is the part that you keep and want to kill. So the homological equation that you want to solve is the following one. Essentially, you remove the non-resonant part from the perturbation. And you get this by dividing by one over Xi.k in the region where you can, in the non-resonant region. Of course, here I am a bit cheating. I mean, actually, these cutoffs can be done in a S-infinity way, okay? So essentially by using cutoff functions, you can do these cutoffs in a S-infinity way, but here I want to just to give the idea. So this is a bit technical, and you simply introduce a cutoff in this region and you multiply the Fourier transform of B by these cutoffs. Then actually if you impose the actually in this region, you have a good estimate of G, because actually the power of epsilon is smaller than one. And then the denominator is actually has an estimate, which is epsilon to the minus delta. But here you have an epsilon which comes from the perturbation. And then this tells you that the generating function is still small. Is of order epsilon to the power one minus delta, and then you can iterate the procedure and you go to up to order, let's say epsilon to the power n, by doing a sufficiently large number of steps. Okay. Let me go actually to the quantum normal form. So actually I need an analog of generating functions and normal form transformations. So clearly, it is quite intuitive to take generating functions, which are quantization of classical generating functions. So essentially my generating function will be self-adjoint pseudo-differential operators of order n. And then actually the normal form transformations are the flows associated to these, the linear flows associated to these linear pseudo-differential operators. And simply by energy estimates, you can prove that this is a well-defined map on Sobolev space, HS, for any S. Then I transform my Schrödinger equation by means of this transformation. And what I get is actually a new Schrödinger equation in which the new vector field is essentially the conjugation of the old vector field, okay? So we have here the conjugation of H, here a term which comes from the time derivative, essentially. So here, to do perturbation theory, you have to do the Lie series, but at the level of the quantum Hamiltonians. So essentially, the Poisson brackets are replaced by the commutators. And actually, up to lower order terms, which means terms which are negligible, in the sense that they have order smaller than the order of the potential V. You have that the relevant term is the commutator between the Laplacian and the generating function plus V equal to some normal form terms, which is as much simple as possible, essentially. But now let me stress the fact that this is exactly the classical normal form, because you have actually pseudo differential calculus. And the key property is the following. The key property is that if you have two pseudo differential operators, one over the M and one over the N, then the commutator is of order M plus N minus one. And you have actually an expansion of the symbol of the commutator, which is actually called Moyle bracket. It is FGM. And these FGM up to lower order terms coincide exactly with the Poisson brackets. Okay, so essentially you can rewrite the quantum homological equation as a classical homological equation. You see this last line of the slide, essentially up to lower order terms, this commutator plus V coincides with the quantization of the Poisson bracket between the unperturbed Hamiltonian and the classical generating function plus V. And so essentially this tells you that formally you have exactly the same homological equation, okay? So essentially this is a small scheme just to summarize a little bit the idea. So you have the quantum Hamiltonian, then you pass to the symbol and you have classical Hamiltonians. Then essentially you do a normal form on and solve homological equations on classical Hamiltonian, and then you quantize the procedure and you get the normal form for H. Okay, so essentially we can work at the classical level. Indeed, the homological equation is formally exactly the same. So this is exactly the same computation that I showed you before. And this is even formally, you have that if you compute the Poisson bracket between psi square and G, you have that you multiply the Fourier transform in X of G by psi dot K. And then in order to kill B, you would like to divide by psi dot K. But here you have actually essentially the same problems that you have in classical mechanics, but the second is a bit different. So the first problem is that you can have exact resonances that you have to avoid. But there is also another problem, which is actually related to the fact that you want to work in the class of pseudo differential operators in order to iterate the procedure and to use symbolic calculus. And then essentially you have to restrict to the regions where the small denominators have a good decay, because you want to keep actually the symbol structure, okay? So a good definition of non-resonant region is actually the following. It is the set of Xi where the denominator is very large compared to Xi, to the power delta. And delta has to be a power which is between zero and one. And then you have also this ultraviolet cutoff, which actually tells you that you have to impose for any point of the phase space a finite number of non-resonance conditions. In this region, actually, the small denominators have a good decay in psi, because one over psi dot k in this region decays like one over psi to the power delta. And then, actually, according to this definition of the non-resonant regions, you have a splitting of the symbols. And also here, you want to kill the non-resonant part. So the splitting is the following. You have actually the average of the symbol, which is the average on the torus of the symbol A. Then you have actually, I call a smoothing part, which is actually a part of the symbol which is supported on high Fourier mods. So modulus of K is smaller than psi to the power eta, to some power eta. And actually it is easy to show that this symbol is smoothing in the sense that it decays as one over psi to the power n for any n. So it is essentially negligible. It already goes to the remainder in the normal form. Then you have actually a non-resonant part, which is actually the part of the symbol that you want to kill, which is supported in the regions where the denominator is large. And then you have the resonant part of the symbol, which is supported in the part of the phase space in which the denominators are small compared to psi, okay? So the homological equation that I want to solve is as before, the aim is to kill the non-resonant part. And And then essentially you define G as actually as you would define it formally, so dividing the Fourier transform of B by Xi dot K, but you restrict it to the region where Xi dot K is larger than Xi to the power delta. Of course, also here you have to do everything in a infinity way. So you represent this cutoff, this restriction by cutoff functions. But then in this region, what happens is the following, is that if Xi is in the non-resonant region, then you have a good decay of the denominators, and then G defined in this way as a decay of this form. So it is Xi to the power M, because M is the order of the perturbation B minus delta. Okay, so essentially G gains some decay in Xi with respect to the perturbation. And this actually allows to iterate the procedure. And the outcome of this iteration is the following normal form lemma, which is the following. So it says that one can construct a unitary map such that you can transform the original equation into another one where you have a normal form operator plus a smoothing remainder. Then the normal form operator, what does it mean? It means that actually it is an operator associated to a normal form symbol, which is essentially of the following form. A normal form symbol, it is a symbol which is supported in the resonant region. So it is supported, each Fourier transform is supported when Xi dot K, the denominators of the normal form are small, and the property is exactly this. So the support is given by, is exactly Xi dot K smaller than Xi to the power delta. But then actually we go to the geometric part, because we need actually a way to analyze the normal form dynamics. And this is actually strongly related to the geometry of these sets. So these sets represent resonances. And actually we have to analyze a little bit their geometry. Let me explain this first a little bit roughly by a picture. So, let me come back also to classical mechanics. First of all, let's fix, do you see the hand, the pointer here?
Yes, we see it.
Ah, thank you, okay, thank you, Marcello, yes, sorry. So first of all, let's fix one direction, okay? So for instance, the direction K equal to 0, 1. So it is essentially this direction. Then what is the resonant hyperplane? It is Xi dot K equals 0. It is exactly this line, okay? So the resonant regions in classical mechanics are these ones, are Xi dot K smaller than epsilon to the power delta. So it is essentially the yellow strip. It is a strip of width, let's say epsilon to the power delta around this line, okay? What happens in the Nekrashov theorem is that the motion of the normal form equation is on this line here. So the intersection between this line and the yellow strip. This is called actually fast drift plane. And so inside here, you do the beatings actually. So you do the beatings inside here. So the motion is actually go ahead and below. I mean, on this strip. And actually what happens is that since the strip is small of order epsilon to the power delta, then the actions does not move for more than epsilon to the power delta. And actually these strips are also invariant for the dynamics. So essentially you can construct a partition of the phase space in invariant sets for the normal form dynamics. And that's exactly what I want to do in the quantum case. But in the quantum case, actually, let's keep also fix the attention on one direction. So the direction K equal to 0, 1. Then the resonance strips the resonant zones in quantum mechanics are the following one, Xi dot K smaller than Xi to the power delta. So essentially they are, I would say parabola, but they are not parabola, but I mean, to do a picture, I represented it as a parabola. And then what happens is the following. Also that you can do a partition of the lattice. The resonant regions are actually disjoint. And also you can do a partition of this parabola in invariant sets for the normal form. So essentially the normal form is invariant on these lines which are orthogonal to the resonant, which are orthogonal to the axis of this parabola. Okay, so you have this line here, then you have another line which contains integer points here, then you have another line and so on. Let me describe maybe more precisely this geometric things that I described in words. So the first, the key lemma, first of all, let me focus only in the b-dimensional case, which actually contains all the ideas and maybe technically can be understood a little bit better. So the first key lemma is the following. The first key lemma is the following. If you have a point of the lattice and you are resonant with the two independent vectors, then automatically you are confined in a ball centered at the origin. So this is actually the key property to do a partition of the lattice in invariant blocks for the normal form operator, because actually this tells you that essentially you have only three possibilities. The first one is that you are in a resonant point. The second one is that you are resonant with only one direction. And the third one is that you are in a ball. So how do you construct a partition of the lattice? You construct in the following way. So you take the non-resonant region as before, but you remove the ball, which is given by the previous lemma. Then you have one directional resonances, which actually formally means that you consider a modulus in Z2. So a modulus is essentially a vector space, but actually with only integer combination of the vector of the basis, essentially. Then you take a one-dimensional modulus in Z2, and then you define the resonant zones corresponding to this modulus in the following way. So they are the resonant vectors with actually the directions which are only in M. And then the previous lemma implies that the following lemma as a corollary, which is actually called in classical mechanics, is called the non-overlapping of the resonances, which tells you that if you take two different directions, then the resonant zones are empty. They have empty intersection. So essentially this gives you a partition of the lattice, which is actually not yet completed, because actually I want also a partition of the lattice, which actually induces an invariant structure, a block diagonal structure on the normal form operator. So I have also to make a partition of the one directional resonant zones in the following way. So I say that if you take two elements in WM, then you can define an equivalence relation in this way. So they are in relation if the difference is parallel to the direction of M. And then the key property of this partition, this is an equivalence relation on WM. The key property of this partition is that if you take two vectors in the same equivalence class, then they have the same orthogonal components. Okay. So essentially the equivalence classes forms, of course, a partition of WM. And this partition is parametrized by the orthogonal direction of WM. So essentially every class is made in the following way. So you fix actually the orthogonal direction and you consider all the vectors which in WM which have this orthogonal direction. And actually this set, so the sets which is the collection which is composed by the non-resonant set, these resonant sets WM beta and the ball centered at the origin form a partition of the lattice Z2. If you want we visualize again these, so the WM beta are exactly these strips. Okay, so fix still a trivial direction K01. then essentially beta is measure how much far I go from the origin on this line. And then you have these classes, W and beta, which are actually these lines here, okay? The key property at the level of the normal form of area. Actually, just if you remark, actually we are all, essentially these are almost the Burgin blocks. Okay, but the Burgin blocks are actually somehow written at the level of matrices. And here we wrote them at the level of pseudo differential operators. But there is a good connection because actually the Weyl quantization of the denominator of psi dot k is exactly the difference of the eigenvalues psi square minus k square. So actually from our blocks, you can pass to Burgin blocks and vice versa. Okay, so there is a quite strong connection actually. Maybe we have not understood completely, but there is a connection. And actually the properties of these blocks, so you have a partition of the lattice, and actually what happens is that the normal form operators leave invariant these elements of the partition. So if you take, for instance, for the one dimensional resonances, you take actually the space generated by the exponentials with the indices in the one directional resonance W and beta, then Z is invariant on these subspaces, okay? And this is actually another crucial property is actually, which is actually also related to the dyadic property of Burgin, which implies that essentially on the blocks, the L2 norm is equivalent to the HS norm. And then you have that essentially the L2 norm, the HS norm is equivalent to the L2 norm up to a factor beta, which represent actually the parametrization of the orthogonal directions of the blocks, okay? This is actually the key property to estimate to analyze the dynamics of our normal form equation. And by using this, one gets one can show that the Sobolev norms stays bounded for all time for the normal form dynamics. Okay. So I think that's all what I wanted to say. And thank you for the attention. And I hope that the
Thank you very much, Riccardo, for the very nice presentation. Do we have any questions?
Also online.
So maybe I have one. So yeah. I mean, that's a very nice question, right? So yeah. I mean, is there then a connection between Arnold diffusion and growth of Sobolev norms instead? I mean, from the classical point of view, you know that you have diffusion.
Yeah, that's a good question, actually. But let's say Arnold diffusion is, if you want the connection is to prove lower bounds on the growth of Sobolev norms. Mm-hmm. And so I think this will be more clear maybe from the talks of Giola and Alberto. I would say that in which maybe they study this turbulent phenomena. I think from the classical point of view, I'm not expert actually in Arnold diffusion. But essentially, let me come back a little bit from in classical mechanics. So the yellow strips, I guess that what you do here in Arnold diffusion is to follow essentially the, for the normal form dynamics, the actions they stand up for all times essentially. Cioè, they move like in this strip, so they move not so much from the unperturbed actions. But then maybe by using some properties of the perturbation, you can go, you can drift actually in this direction. Mm-hmm. So essentially, but not for the normal form. You have to use really the perturbation. You have to create some instability essentially. Cioè, but you don't see the instability in the normal form dynamics. So you have to use a little bit the perturbation.
Mm-hmm. I see.
But I'm not enough expert in Arnold diffusion, so I hope that It's also a very naive answer, I would say, because
it was clear. Other questions? Chiara?
I wanted to ask Riccardo, so you had these lower order terms appearing here and there, and from your talk it seems they were never a problem, so do you control?
Yes. Okay. Yeah, for
instance. You control them.
Yes, for instance here.
Sample
that. Yeah, it means that here it is an iterative. So of course this is one step of the procedure. So in one step you reduce, you go from M to M prime, let's say, with M prime, which is so essentially you reduce to normal form up to order which are smaller than the original order of B. Then you do another step, and then you do another step, and then you do another step. So the lower order terms let's say, negligible by using these properties. So the properties of the symbolic calculus, which tells you that the iterated commutators are really of lower orders. Okay.
Thank you.
So Riccardo, I just want to ask you another
quick question.
So, but is there some, how much of this extends to some nonlinear cases, right? I mean, if you...
Yes, we did something actually preliminary in the sense that, on the irrational, on irrational tori, we did on irrational tori, because actually, we did actually a Birkhoff normal form theorem, only one step, in the case of Schrödinger equation with the quadratic nonlinearity on irrational tori, just to understand, let's say, the simplest situation in which you have three-wave interactions, which have a very bad estimates, because on irrational torus you have a very strong phenomenon of accumulation. And then we provide an existent time of order epsilon to the minus two by essentially providing a nonlinear analog of this method, okay? So the nonlinear analog of this method has the ingredient of paradifferential operators, which is actually an analog of pseudo-differential operators to symbols which depends nonlinearly on the unknown. And then you can actually do this procedure in that framework. And also you can improve actually the time of existence. We hope that also to go beyond, but we did this preliminary result with Roberto Feola on irrational tori by actually combining essentially the pseudo differential calculus with these normal form methods. Okay.
Okay, thanks a lot, Riccardo. Is there a question from Zoom? No? Okay. So thanks a lot, Riccardo, again for the very nice talk, and thanks to all the speakers of today, and see you tomorrow.